really my great honor and pleasure to introduce someone that of whose work I'm a great admirer and I have deep respect for. Laura Brown is the author of Cultural Competence in Trauma Treatment, Beyond the Flashback, published by APA in 2008, in addition to 13 other books and 150 other publications. She's a former Division 56 president who practices in Seattle, Washington. Dr. Brown, welcome to our webinar series.
Dan, thanks. So all of you need to know that because I use an XP computer, I wasn't able to run the GoToWebinar software. So I'm going to be saying next so that Jan can flash the PowerPoint slides to you at appropriate time. So let's go to slide two because you don't have to look at the cover slide. What I want to do is give you an overview of how I think about the cultural competence topic. And I think a lot of us in our training get the this is how to work with Bajorans perspective, Bajorans being a Star Trek ethnic group. We learn how to have a set of rules and a set of guidelines for working with Bajorans and Klingons and Romulans and Vulcans, but it doesn't really help us think in a broader way about what cultural competence is about. And so that's the models, the thinking in a broader way model that I'm going to be talking about today and that I've been writing about and talking about for quite a while. So it's about epistemologies. How do you think and how do you know about being culturally competent? It's about developing some attitudinal norms. And the metaphor I use comes from the martial art I practice, Aikido. Aikido is a martial art that's about connection and relationship. We are about the peaceful resolution of conflict, helping people who attack you to fall down on the floor rather than hitting them or kicking them or punching them. And it's a very intimate martial art. You're very up close and personal. There's times when your attacker's head is cradled gently on your shoulder. And we train in our bare feet. And so because we're training in our bare feet, we're being very physically close. We step on one another's toes on a fairly regular basis. And when someone steps on my toe or I step on someone's toe, the assumption is it was accidental. There was no malicious intent. Everyone says, I'm sorry. Make sure that the toe is okay. But the assumption is always of goodwill. And in doing cultural competence work, we have to do that same assumption of goodwill. We are going to step on one another's toes if we get close enough to genuinely connect across the lines of difference. And so knowing that part of becoming culturally competent is that you will step on toes, you will make errors, and that your toes will be stepped on. Other people will make errors in relationship to you. And that assuming a stance of cultural competence as a practitioner means working from the perspective of all toe stepping is done accidentally because you don't know the toe is there or because you haven't quite mastered not stepping on the toe. And that being offended and being offensive are part of the currency of developing cultural competence. There's no way to avoid that unless you keep a distance. If you keep a distance from other people, if you keep a distance from difference, then you won't offend anybody. Then you can look and sound pretty good. But part of taking on cultural competence is knowing that you're going to mess up. And then taking responsibility for it so that when someone does you the honor of saying, you know, ouch, that you say, thank you for taking the risk to tell me. So piece of it is being open to hearing that you stepped on a toe rather than saying, well, I couldn't tell that was a toe, or gee, isn't your toe really sensitive? Saying, wow, you took a risk to let me know. Thank you. So having an attitudinal perspective of willingness to take risk, willingness to make mistakes, and willingness to make amends. I'll be using some terminology today, some of which is becoming more and more common. I'll talk about target groups, groups that historically or currently have been targets of oppression, systemic discrimination, harassment, and dominant or agent groups, those groups that are socially constructed at a particular time in a particular culture as the cultural dominant in hierarchies of power and value. So long sentence, which means dominant group membership is very dependent upon where you are, and people can lose dominant agent group membership because of things that happen in their lives. Mindfulness about the language we use is another important piece of moving toward a cultural competence. Why I don't use the term minority groups is for a couple of reasons. One of them is minority implies less than. And the other one is that these groups that we've called minorities in Western culture are in fact becoming these numerical majorities. So it's neither culturally competent nor statistically accurate to use that terminology. And finally, why am I using Star Trek ethnic groups? Those of you who are Star Trek fans are all saying, yay, another Star Trek junkie. Because talking about cultural competence is generally somewhat anxiety-provoking. It's anxiety-provoking for members of agent groups because there's this fear of feeling guilty or ashamed. It's anxiety-provoking for members of target groups because there's this reasonable fear that you're going to have somebody not just step on your toes, but kind of punch you in the stomach somewhere along the way. So talking about Star Trek ethnic groups, there's usually no Star Trek ethnic groups in the room or on the webinar, although with this, who knows, there may be a Bajoran on the webinar. We don't know. But it's a way that I've found that allows us to kind of settle down and reduce the activation of our HPA axis and think about what is this difference all about. Also because Star Trek did a really good job of getting me and a lot of other people to think about what difference meant. So next slide, please. So I got my degree in 1977, which seems like a really long time ago. And when I was in graduate school, as Robert Guthrie said, even the rat was white. It was also male, middle class, and a Midwestern college sophomore. The science of psychology that I inherited when I started graduate school in 1973 was the study of members of the dominant group at every possible level of intersection of identities. And so the very fact that in the 70s we began to have the handbook of psychotherapy with African Americans and, you know, psychology of women and LGBT people and you fill in the blank, it was kind of an astonishing thing that there was some acknowledgement that human beings were a diverse lot and that we were not all members of agent groups on every single facet of our identities. It was a good start. It was a problematic good start, but it was a good start. Problematic because, first of all, it defined competence as acquisition of a specific body of knowledge about a specific group. So you would learn that if you were working with Bajorans, you should not make comments about their big dangly ear cuffs or the fact that they wore red a lot, and you should ask them about the prophets because Bajorans are very spiritual. You learned rules. So then when the Bajoran came into your office who was not really playing by the rules, you were a little stymied. Your competence flew out the window. There was also the problem that the parameters of the knowledge of this whole body of work were those as defined by the dominant culture of psychology, which is that it had to be quote-unquote objective, objectivity being what the dominant agent group calls their own subjectivity. And it had to fall into categories that psychology had defined as reasonable categories. So it would be looking at traditional folk healers as versus how this culture does emotional healing. So cute pejorative terms would be used to describe things in a culture that in our culture were elevated and valued. It was always knowledge about the other. So if you were a psychology graduate student who was a member of a target group, the books and articles were addressed to you as if you were a member of the agent group. By becoming a psychologist, you sort of per se lost your target group status. But it was, let's be the objective dominant group person observing this group of people. This knowledge was about them. It wasn't about us. It wasn't about the person of the psychotherapist. And it wasn't about subjective experiences of clients. Next slide, please. So it was, as I said, rules. And it constructed identity as singular. In the 21st century, we've gotten pretty clear that what Kimberly Crenshaw first called intersectionality is really what identity is about. Identity is about multiple aspects of self that intertwine in different ways depending upon the social context and the demand characteristics of that context. But the original rat not white was you're either a brown rat, or you're a female rat, or you're a queer rat, or you're a rat with disabilities, or you're an old rat, but you have to pick one. So that was problematic. And competence, as I said, was defined as acquiring and using a correct set of rules. And supposedly you were neutral, you as a psychotherapist were neutral and free of bias, which as I'm about to say in a few minutes and say a lot again this morning, and it's morning where I am, I'm in Seattle. So my frame of reference is really early in the morning, that bias is something human beings can't not have. Next slide, please. So the positive effect is it at least opened the discourse, and it created this huge awareness that there were missing pieces in how psychology was thinking about almost everybody. And interestingly, as we came to know later, how psychology was thinking about members of aging groups, how we thought about cisgender men, how we thought about Euro-American people, was also not very thoughtful or culturally competent. It got people interested and concerned, and it legitimized this discourse to some degree. And I should tell all of you that in the late 1980s, I was on a Division of Clinical Psychology listserv for about 2 minutes, in which a very famous clinical psychologist of the time said that it's not psychology's concern to be talking about issues of difference and ethnicity and gender. Those are sociology's and anthropology's concerns. And I bring that up to say that the legitimization within psychology of discussions of difference in cultural competence is a very recent and highly resisted phenomenon. Next slide, please. Problematic effects of this is that people had a false sense of competence. I took the workshop on working with Klingons, and so I know how to work with Klingons. No, you don't. And it completely downplayed the fact that cultural competence is a relational, contextual, and political phenomenon. Mental health professions have had a politicized and, in many cases, colonizing and oppressive role in relationship to members of target groups. And that wasn't being taken into account in these early discussions of how to be allegedly culturally competent. Also imposed dominant cultural categories, mental illness versus physical illness, as opposed to some cultures' ways of understanding distress as a holistic phenomenon in which embodied expressions of distress and brained expressions of distress were not separated from one another. And difference was defined as essential. It was about phenotype, known in Western culture as race, and other biological factors, sex assigned at birth. So it was a very essentialist and deterministic phenomenon rather than looking at how identity is an interplay between biological experience and social experience. Next slide, please. So what we get to instead of this, I know how to treat Klingons, is instead a stance of ignorance and humility. So all of us went to graduate school and then beyond have taken many CE courses trying to know everything we possibly can. Ignorance has not been really consistent with the identity of the psychologist. But in fact, ignorance and humility are important beginning stances for the development of cultural competence. And the story I tell comes from a book by Ursula Le Guin called The Left Hand of Darkness, a book that disrupted narratives of gender back in the early 1970s. And I read it while I was busy avoiding writing my dissertation, which many of you on this webinar will appreciate the avoiding writing dissertation phenomenon. Le Guin has an overarching conceit that a humanoid species called the Hainish went around the galaxy, found the planets that would support humanoid life, seeded them with humanoid life, and then had a technological breakdown, lost connection, and now finally got their technology back together for faster than light travel and communication, and are sending out emissaries to all those planets to say, hi, cousins. We're back. Come on in. In other words, it's a series of what in sci-fi we call first contact novels. They're anthropological because Le Guin was raised in an anthropological household by her father, the anthropologist Theodore Kroeber. And so in The Left Hand of Darkness, the humanoid, the human from our planet, Genli I, goes to the planet Winter, where the entire species is intersexed. People are both male and female at different times in their lives, can both give birth to a child and father a child, which was the message that Le Guin was trying to send, which is gender is a social construct. It's very confusing to Genli I, who wants to put people into two boxes, male or female. But because he's an anthropologist, he's studying the planet as well as saying, hello, cousins, I'm here. And so he decides to study the spiritual practices of the planet, and he goes climbing up the mountain to visit the foretellers, one of the spiritual groups, and he meets the first foreteller and says, I want to study with you because I'm very ignorant. And the foreteller says to him, don't boast, because the foretellers are Taoists, and they believe that great ignorance is great wisdom. So I'm in graduate school reading this thinking, oh, could I talk to my professors about this and maybe skip comprehensive exams? That, of course, didn't work very well. But when I began to work in the field of cultural competence, I realized that this was an important stance to take, that the more I think I know, the more I do not know. And so you're all going to come away from today somewhat more ignorant, I hope, or at least willing to embrace your ignorance and humility, and to move to what are called emic models. And an emic model, first of all, acknowledges explicitly the intersectionalities of identities, and acknowledges explicitly that knowing a person, it requires understanding their social locations, the intersection between their social realities and the ways that they perceive themselves. It also requires not just knowing a lot of facts, but a lot of emotional competence on our part. Because cultural competence, as I'm construing it, is a great deal more about our own attitudes and self-awareness, and more about our ability to understand what we symbolize to one another, what other people symbolize to us. And cultural competence in trauma treatment requires specific attention to the ways in which trauma is interwoven into identities or affects components of people's identities, both embedded and recently acquired trauma. So it's looking at trauma as one of many components of intersectionality. Next slide, please. Have I gotten us to intellectual emotional competence? I'm not sure I said next slide, please.
That's okay. I got you.
That's okay. Thanks, Jan. So we're moving towards what I think of as 21st century cultural competence, which is a combination of emotional and intellectual competence, to hold the ambiguity of our own and our clients' intersectionalities, to look at the ways in which different components of identity emerge more foreground in different social contexts and locations, and to see how trauma is a component of people's narratives of identity, to be really aware of our own biases and prejudices, and to be aware in a mindful, self-compassionate manner, and to be aware of our own cultural identities and their meanings for ourselves, including our cultural histories of trauma and our personal histories of trauma, and then to embrace the fact that we are human. Next slide, please. So in Star Trek Next Generation, which is my favorite of the many Star Trek series, there's a character named Lieutenant Commander Data. And Data is an android, not the OS for the phone, but a humanoid appearing positronic computer brain living in a mechanical body covered in a metallic humanoid skin. And when Data was constructed, his creator left out the chip on which the subroutine for emotion was written. So Data doesn't have affect, and he spends the entire series studying these strange humanoid creatures who have affect, trying to understand love and fear and longing and desire and rage and all those things. In the first Star Trek movie, he meets his literally evil twin who got the chip. He gets him the chip. The chip is inserted, and immediately Data needs DBT because he has no emotion regulation skills. But the point of this all, like, why is she talking about Data, is that we have that subroutine for emotion. We have a limbic system. We have an amygdala. And the amygdala's whole job from 6 months of age onward is to notice difference and code it as danger. And it has to be classically conditioned to code the difference as not danger, for us not to be noticing and responding to difference in a something dangerous is here way. And there's a good reason for this. We are the descendants of hominids who millions of years ago roamed the African savanna as prey animals. And we didn't have, our ancestors did not have the opportunity to sit and think, is that rumbling in the bushes a megafauna that's going to eat me or just the wind? We had to get up the tree really fast. We are the descendants of the hominids who had really well-developed amygdalas and limbic systems. And our limbic systems go into action much more quickly than do our orbital prefrontal cortex and our neocortex, all of which are the parts that say, oh, no, that's just the wind. So for survival reasons, we respond really quickly to difference, and we code it as danger. We code change as danger. We code all those things as danger. And so we cannot not have bias, because we have a limbic system. And then we also have our lived experience in which we have modeling and classical conditioning of certain kinds of experiences or modeled experiences to our own limbic arousal. So if we're walking down the street with our parents and we're 2 years old and the Bajoran family's across the street with their kids and our parents say, oh, let's go over and say hi to the Bajoran neighbors and let's set up a play date, we get classically conditioned, okay, Bajoran's good. If we're walking down the street and our grown-ups say, oh my God, it's those damn Bajorans, let's walk faster the other way, what gets modeled and therefore conditioned is Bajoran's dangerous, scary. We have bias because we are human. And we have these overlearned responses. We live in the 21st century where psychologists are not supposed to have bias, and yet we're human, and so we have it. And we often feel ashamed and guilty about our bias. Part of developing cultural competence is being willing to embrace the fact that we are human and we have bias. Next slide, please. So we have this myth that we're unbiased, and this is not accurate because we, first of all, have our own experiences of being insiders and outsiders. We have our own experiences as members of target groups. We have our own standpoints and intersectionalities in our identities. There's the fact that we have power, and in relationships, our biases therefore take more power. And there's non-conscious dynamics. So what we have to take a look at is our own aversive bias. And if you haven't read the work of DeVideo and Greenwald and Gartner and Banerjee and others, non-conscious bias, aversive bias, is the unconscious bias held by people of goodwill who would like not to be biased. We are the I'm not biased but folks. And almost everybody has some kind of aversive bias. It's disowned. We're not supposed to do this. But it's not a private affair. DeVideo has done some very interesting studies looking at the effect on simple problem-solving tasks of having a person with aversive bias in the room. And aversive bias leads to incongruent behavior, to weird distancing behavior, and it leads to the aversively biased person coming across as untrustworthy. And so if it affects a simple problem-solving task, and I'm going to, for the interest of time, not describe the study in detail, but suggest that people go look it up and look up the work of DeVideo and his colleagues on the topic of aversive bias, that it affects our interpersonal relationships and it affects how we are across difference. Next slide, please. So what happens with aversive bias that we haven't explored and owned is we create crazy-making emotional data for members of target groups. If we're the dominant agent group member who is trying not to have aversive bias and say, I'm a good person, I'm not biased, except I'm leaking. And ironically, in DeVideo's research, overtly racist people were deemed more trustworthy by his African-American participants because they weren't incongruent. And as we know as psychotherapists, congruence is especially important in our work with trauma survivors, where incongruence gets coded as even greater danger. Next slide, please. I'm just going to say here's a link for assessing your own aversive bias. And moving toward cultural competence means being willing to uncover and confront our own non-conscious bias in a mindful, self-compassionate way. So rather than saying, oh my God, I'm so biased, to say, oh, look, I'm human. How can I own this rather than run away from it? I see it from the psychotherapy perspective as a form of countertransference, which we then shame ourselves about because while many forms of countertransference are accepted these days, and as Constance Dahlenberg has pointed out, countertransference is an important phenomenon to understand when we're working with trauma survivors, if we shame ourselves for our countertransferential feelings, we are less likely to explore them, to work them through, or to use them for the benefit of the therapy rather than in a way that's undermining to the therapy. So next slide, please. So if we shame ourselves for our countertransference, we're going to engage in four behaviors, all of which are undermining to cultural competence. We will distance from the source of our shame. We will blame the source of our shame. We will attempt to fuse with the source of our shame, or we will hate ourselves for the source of, for having shame. And I think that all of those, I think everyone on this call can appreciate that, those are not things that help us engage in the heart-to-heart connection that is essential for effective treatment of trauma. I've got some questions here I'm not going to go into in detail, but encourage you to explore about how your shame over aspects of your identity or your bias might affect your ability to be present with clients when you have those feelings coming up. The other thing that therapists feel shame about that undermines our cultural competence is privilege. And privilege has gotten kind of radioactive recently, and I'm not comfortable with the whole check your privilege meme, because what that does is shame people about the fact that privilege is there. Privilege is not something that we seek, and it's often something that people are unaware of until they begin to examine themselves. It's an is. You don't choose to be born into a particular phenotype or into a particular sex or into a particular social class or into a particular place and time in the world. It's simply something you have. And cultural competence means becoming aware of our privilege in a self-compassionate way and being aware of how it distorts our perspectives on reality. Privilege teaches you that the playing field is level when it's not, that things are straightforward when they're complex, and that life is fair when it's not. And so being willing to be aware of privilege, and if people can just move to the next slide, please, for some examples, which I'm not going to belabor. And each of us can probably notice ways in which we have both some privilege and we have the absence of privilege, because when we have intersectional identities, we are likely to have both privilege and its absence. And for those of you who currently have privilege on almost every aspect of your intersectionalities, if you're lucky enough to get old, you will lose privilege at least on that variable. And it's interesting, for those of you who are readers of the New York Times, last Sunday had an article by Harris Swafford, who was a previously heterosexually identified upper middle class cisgender Euro-American man, a former senator from Pennsylvania, who came out about the fact that he's now about to marry a man. So he threw away his privilege in public. He's also 90, so he's lost some privilege around age. So we can lose privilege at lots of different points in our life, or also acquire privilege, although privilege generally is something that is more difficult to acquire and easier to lose. The point around cultural competence is rather than, oh my God, I have privilege, I'm a bad person, it's like, how does this distort my understanding of a trauma survivor's experience, of another human being's experience? How can I see that privilege or the absence of privilege gives me a particular standpoint that, if I examine it, will allow me to see my clients and myself more clearly? And I just skipped two slides, Jan, to privilege and cultural competence. Sorry, guys, I realized I have way more material, as usual, than I can cover in the time available. That if we look at our privilege and our bias with compassion, that it's there, that what's important for cultural competence is self-awareness, managing the shame and guilt so that we don't distance from our clients and we don't feel guilty and disengage or become disingenuous with them. If we can acknowledge our bias and privilege, we actually open up the doors for a stronger therapeutic alliance. And I'm not going to cover in detail this slide about guilty awareness, so Jan, we can forward up to from awareness of privilege to alliance, to slide 22. So when we develop this compassionate self-awareness of our bias and our privilege, what we can move toward is an anti-domination stance. And the anti-domination stance is, I'm either a part of the solution or I'm a part of the problem. There are no bystanders. And in the field of trauma psychology, we know that the bystander is as much a part of the person being traumatized as the actual source of the trauma, that the unwillingness to engage, to intervene, creates the sense of abandonment and betrayal for the person who's being traumatized. Thus, so cultural competence. Either own the fact that as a Euro-American person born and raised in a particular time in a particular social class, I'm racist, I'm sexist, I'm classist, I'm heterosexist, I'm all of those things. Not because I'm a bad person, rather because I'm a human being raised in a culture that is saturated with these various oppressive memes. So I can acknowledge these things to be true about myself and then say, what am I going to do to change that? I can be part of the solution. I cannot say if I'm going to take a culturally competent anti-domination stance. I cannot say I'm not racist. What I can say is, I'm a Euro-American person, therefore I am racist. Therefore, I have to look at the ways in which my racism expresses itself and work to combat racism, and so on and so on. And that's a particularly salient issue for trauma treatment, because A lot of trauma arises from both institutionalized and normalized dynamics of oppression. And if we look carefully for a minute at natural disasters are traumatic, but how the larger system responds to people after they've been on the receiving end of a natural disaster is where the betrayal, the institutional betrayal, shows up. And that's what ends up being traumatizing. There was an interesting series of studies done with elders who had survived not only Hurricane Katrina, but also earlier hurricanes and floods in the late 1920s. And what those elders said was, the flood and the hurricane was bad, but we knew what to do to deal with it. Being left to die by the government, that's what traumatized us. And who was left to die by the government? The poor, the African American, the people who were marginalized. And so looking at standing with the oppressed is a part of culturally competent trauma treatment. It doesn't mean that everyone who's been traumatized is oppressed. It means that having that mindset of, I am working to change this, even though I didn't cause it. Because it's relatively easy for me, and I'll use myself as an example. I'm a Jew. All of my family came here early 1920s. Therefore, you know, they didn't hold slaves. They didn't participate in genocide against American Indians. And yet, I'm the beneficiary of all of that. They were the beneficiaries of all of that. My grandfather, who came to the United States in the early 1920s, not speaking a lick of English, could join the Carpenters Union in Cleveland because he had white skin. It took a lawsuit in the 1960s for African Americans born in Cleveland, speaking perfect English, to get into that self-same union. So we can't say, I didn't do this, so it's not my problem. We have to say, I benefit from it, therefore I am responsible for doing what I can to change it. And taking that stance increases our cultural competence and deepens our ability to form empathic bonds with our trauma survivor clients. Next slide, please. So it's really about changes in attitude, looking at our own dynamics of internalized oppression, if we are members of target groups, and internalized domination, if we are members of agent groups, and both, for those of us who have all kinds of things in our intersectionalities, to be willing to make mistakes, and to make diversity core to our understanding. So not just say, oh, I need to get culturally competent because I'm working with Bajorans, but cultural competence imbues everything I do. If I'm evaluating a heterosexual, cisgender, Euro-American, middle-class, able-bodied man, I'm bringing my culturally competent lens to that because understanding all of those narratives and what it means that they've been disrupted is important for my understanding of that person. So it's not just a therapeutic alliance, but it's a culturally competent alliance around the larger social context and what occurs. And for some people, it's ubiquitous. Next slide, please. And so how does this manifest? I think, first of all, it deepens our empathic relating. It deepens it by letting us know what we can't really understand, because deeper empathy is saying, I will never understand what it's like to walk around like that. What I can understand is that you are in enormous pain, rather than, oh yeah, I can understand what it's like to be Bajoran because I'm Jewish. It's like, no, I have my own history, my own cultural history, and that's different from being a Bajoran. And I think oftentimes people attempt to draw on empathy by saying, well, yeah, I know what it's like because my people this and that. No, it's being able to say, I will never know what it's like to be you. I can relate to the pain. Also, it's about talking about the elephants in the room, to be able to say, so as we start our work together, can we talk about these issues of difference? Because if we as the therapist don't take the bull by the horns and initiate the conversation about difference, what we do is we effectively silence it by being the powerful person in the room who says this isn't something that needs to be on the table. By attending to the phenomenon of representation, when and where I enter. Anna Julia Cooper, a 19th century African-American suffrage activist, said, when and where I enter, then and there, the whole race enters with me. And that's true for all of us. When and where we enter, there's representation. Members of target groups are often very aware of representation because we're called upon to represent. For years, I was the official lesbian in psychology, which was such an interesting experience. People who are primarily agent group in our identities may not be as aware of representation, But we think of this as transference and countertransference, broadening it within the culturally competent model, which is it's not simply those non-conscious variables, it's also the socially visibly available variables that are in the room. And then acknowledging the intrusions of the real into the treatment room. When in the news, African American people are being slaughtered by law enforcement authorities, that matters in the treatment room. That matters, that's something that affects what's happening between us and our clients, whether there's a person of color in the room or not, because the fatal dynamics of traumatizing oppression are in the world in an undeniable way. And it's been interesting for me to notice how much that all shows up, no matter what the identities of our clients are, when I, as a therapist, make it clear that I'm open to hearing about that. I'm not going to talk about the whole alliance thing, so I'm going to skip two slides forward to when and where we enter trauma, because entering the context of trauma, in addition to our clients' other identities and social locations, means we also have to understand what trauma represents to us because of our experiences and our identities. How does this person's trauma experience evoke our experiences and our symbologies of being a perpetrator, a bystander, or a target? How does this person's experience of trauma resonate to or activate our own trauma awareness? Because if we're aware of how the trauma in question intersects with our identities, it will also improve the quality of our capacities to be in the room with that person. Next slide, please. So another big piece of cultural competence is learning our own identities. In the past, cultural competence was learning about everybody else. But from a stance of alliance and from the cultural competence model that I'm using, it's really about learning about ourselves. And the model that I use, I'm going to skip two slides to addressing, is a model developed by Pam Hayes, and in fact her most recent edition of the book, so it's the updated references and the references of this PowerPoint. Pam Hayes is the addressing model, and there's a bunch of different acronym models. In the UK, there's the GRACES model, and Michael D'Andrea has the, I think, the RESPECT model, but these are all acronyms for understanding intersectional identities. And what I'm going to do is not read those slides. I'm simply going to tell you what addressing stands for, then skip way forward. Addressing is age and age cohort. The two Ds are disability. R is... I've lost it. R is religion and spirituality. E is ethnic identity. S is socioeconomic status. The first S. The second S, sexual orientation. I is indigenous heritage, colonization history. N is national identity, which means immigration, refugee status, undocumented people. And G is gender, which is includes biological sex and gender identity. So I'm going to skip over to... slide 34, and talk about power and empowerment as culturally competent trauma practice. And I apologize for trying to go fast, but I want to leave time for questions. So part of understanding ourselves and our clients is looking at all those aspects of intersectionality, to which you can add things like, is a person employed or not? Is a person a parent or not? Is a person coupled or not? Or are they in a polyamorous relationship, which is a target group relationship status, for example? And are they a trauma survivor? Because trauma survivors are a target group. Trauma survivors are stigmatized. And for everyone on the call who are themselves a trauma survivor, because there are always trauma survivors in the rooms, what we know is that being a trauma survivor is also a target group status, particularly in disciplines which stigmatize and diagnose people who have a history of trauma. Culturally competent practice identifies ways in which people can be powerful, because trauma undermines personal power. It is a disempowerment experience. And I'm not going to read the four locations of power slide, so I'm going to let you all read them and skip over them in talking about it, but simply say that understanding ways in which people can become empowered includes understanding and inviting people to understand ways in which they have culturally and identity-informed paths to power that the dominant culture may neither realize nor acknowledge. Okay, I obviously needed 3 hours to do this. Sorry, folks. So I'm going to talk really briefly about these other pieces. So trauma can become a component of identity. I'm at slide 39 now. Mm-hmm. And part of how it becomes a component of identity is historically. Cultures that have historically been the target of genocide, of colonization, of oppression, or trauma can become a component of identity, for example, through sexual abuse, through hate crimes associated with one's identity, through losses associated with one's identity. And experiences of trauma can also affect people's capacity to respond. So dominant and agent group membership may be a risk factor for not being able to handle trauma, because cultures that have been traumatized and colonized have often developed strategies and rituals for dealing with trauma. Members of dominant or agent groups may be very invested in a just world narrative because of the experience of privilege. And trauma undermines the just world narrative. And so there may be more of a sense of trauma and betrayal if you've believed in the just world, which often comes with agent and dominant group identities. I'm going to skip over slides 41 and move to slide 42 briefly and say that culturally competent trauma practice means also understanding trauma beyond criterion A. Criterion A is a perfectly fine place to start, but there's other things. And briefly, what I'm going to talk about is insidious trauma, also known as microaggression, first identified by Maria Root. And then I'm going to go to slide 45. So the isms, racism, classism, sexism, heterosexism. Oppression can be, and I believe often is, traumatic, either directly or indirectly. Slide 46 now, sorry, going fast. As I said earlier, the notion that loss of the just world is traumatic, which appears to be particularly true for members of dominant or agent groups. We also have the traumagenic culture, in which traumatizing events are built into what happens around us. And I'm going to skip the myths piece and go to slide 50, which is what I think of as the boundary conditions for doing culturally competent trauma therapies. That we function as an ally, which means we are not neutral. Frank Ochberg, one of the founders of the trauma therapy field, said years ago, a neutral trauma therapist is an unsuccessful trauma therapist because neutrality is perceived as disengagement, disbelief. We join with the client. We tell the truth about how bad things were. We recognize both their pre-trauma and current competencies, and reframing symptoms as biopsychosocial existential attempts to solve the problem of being trauma exposed and the brain's attempts to process the trauma. And culturally competent trauma treatment tells the truth about a traumagenic context that can impede recovery, rather than saying, this person isn't responding to the prescribed number of sessions of exposure therapy, to say, how is it that they're also having uncontrolled exposures repeatedly in their daily life that's undermining their ability to recover? Empowerment also means, and next slide, please, seeing our clients' experiences as the intersection of their identities with the trauma experience and offering that vision to our clients. So inviting them to see how this particular event re-evokes or activates personal or cultural historical trauma or undermines personal or cultural coping strategies. And taking a collaborative approach to the work that we do with people rather than a prescriptive or authoritarian approach. Even if the person with whom we're working seems very disorganized by the trauma, and always asking, what's the most powerful thing, however small, that you can do in this moment? So how is it that the person can notice that they have that capacity? It means also identifying resilience, because particularly cultures with histories of trauma, oppression, and colonization have cultural resilience and resistance strategies, humor, rituals, and storytelling. Look at the roster of successful stand-up comedians and notice how frequently it's the case that they are people with either cultural histories of trauma or their own struggles with illness, violation, something that they're transforming with humor. Integrating cultural resilience into the recovery process, so asking someone, what do you think your grandmother would have done to deal with this? Because that raises questions about what's already available rather than overprivileging mental health interventions. Slide 53. So one size does not fit all in trauma treatment. The evidence-based treatments for trauma, which I've recently had the opportunity to very thoroughly review, only account for a small percentage of the variance of outcome. They don't always help, and what needs to be added is cultural and relational competence. Trauma has a meaning. It's not simply an event that has certain kinds of responses. And culturally competent trauma treatment means the trauma therapist has taken all these issues into account and looks at how the trauma has meaning that is created by the social context, by our clients' intersectionality of identities, and by cultural trauma histories. And so culturally competent treatment takes a biopsychosocial, spiritual, existential approach, understanding trauma as something that attaches to identities and that affects people's relationships with the larger social system. So it's my sense that trauma recovery doesn't take place in the absence of cultural competence by the clinician. And by trauma recovery, I mean not simply the eradication of PTSD symptoms, also the restoration of meaning, because beyond intrusive thoughts and change cognitions and nightmares and hypervigilance, trauma evokes changed meanings and changed understanding of oneself and the world. Even a car accident has meaning in terms of the social locations and intersectionalities of the identities of the parties involved. Because if you're here in Seattle and your car is total and you work at Amazon, you can afford to deal with everything that's happened and pay for the things your insurance doesn't pay for. But if you are the person working behind the counter selling candy at the airport and you're making 15 bucks an hour and your car is totaled, you can't deal with that as easily. Even a car accident has meanings that have to do with social class and social location and access to resources. And if it happens that you are the Amazon employee whose car is totaled and you were a refugee from Somalia, then your trauma related to what that was all about is probably going to get activated as well in a way that if you're the Amazon employee who grew up here in Seattle, Euro-American, you don't have that same experience to get activated by this next trauma. Even a car accident trauma has meanings that have to do with the identity of who is sitting there in the car when it gets driven into. So when we integrate cultural competence and awareness into whatever intervention we're doing, we can increase our clients' empowerment and their potentials for healing. So last slide 55, our responsibility ultimately in culturally competent practice is to become aware of our bias and privilege, to not shame ourselves, to become aware of what we represent, to increase our ignorance and humility, and to be allies who see ourselves as part of the solution, not only because we're offering an evidence-based intervention, but because we are offering an awareness of who is in the room, both of us, as we are doing this. So that was really fast. I've got a lot of reading. I know questions have come in, and Jan is going to feed them to me.
Okay.
So I was doing
Thank
a three-hour talk in 45 minutes. Oy, oy, oy.
Thank you so much, Laura. Let me start off with this first question. Can you talk more about the impact of incongruence on trauma survivors and how it is encoded as danger?
So I should say first off that I work primarily with survivors of childhood developmental trauma, so interpersonal trauma. Mm-hmm. But in general, incongruence, and if we look at basic information about effectiveness in psychotherapy, incongruence undermines all psychotherapy. Congruence is an evidence-based relationship variable that's necessary for therapy to be effective. But I think for trauma survivors, it's particularly important because trauma survivors are often carefully reading interpersonal cues to see if they are safe in the room with us. Are we worthy of their trust? Will we listen to their story with a believing mind, or will we be undermining them or dismissing them in some way? And we've got some data on the fact that individuals who've been traumatized, particularly people with a history of interpersonal trauma, have some challenges in developing trust in their relationships with psychotherapists. And if we are incongruent, if we're sending off incongruent messages at the nonverbal level and our clients are carefully scanning for that, it's going to be more difficult for them to develop trust, more difficult for them to do the very hard work of trauma therapy, since most trauma treatment involves some degree of exposure to the trauma material. Why should someone take that risk if they believe that we are not worthy of their trust and they can't read accurately what's going on with us? So being willing and able to say, is there something you need to check out? And checking ourselves carefully to be congruent in our expressions of what's happening for us, I think, is a part of trust building. And trust building, I believe, to be particularly central to the work that we do with trauma survivors, if we want to be able to successfully develop a therapeutic alliance. And the therapeutic alliance is something that makes a difference, not just in trauma treatment, but in treatment kind of across the board.
Okay. Thank you. Here's the next question. When we're talking about aversive bias, mm-hmm. What if the therapist is aware but covers up in denial? So how can you address that? Knowing that that can lead to the client suffering the consequences of the denial.
So what I want to say to all of us is, let's just own our biases, all of them, because that leads to the incongruence and the avoidance and the weird shit, excuse my French, that DeVideo found in his research. We have to be willing to go in and embrace the human beings that we are and not deny it. And this goes back, interestingly, to an article by Ken Pope and Barbara Tabachnik on therapists' feelings of hate, disgust, anger towards our clients, which we also are in denial about. And we've got really nice research that shows that therapists have all of these aversive affects. We feel hatred and disgust and anger and frustration and judgment. And if we don't embrace that reality, what happens is that the clients pick up that something's going on and they deem us not trustworthy. So when we're in denial about it, whether it's I don't feel comfortable around Klingons because Klingons tend to be violent, or you remind me of my mother and so I don't really like you, if we don't notice those countertransferential phenomena, and aversive bias in therapists is a countertransferential phenomenon, we don't address it, we're in denial about it, we undermine the therapy, and we increase the likelihood of premature termination and of not being helpful. So what I think is that we need to get supervision and consultation from folks who understand that this is normative, who don't shame us, and who say, of course you have these feelings. And let's take a look at what they're about, and let's take a look at how they manifest, and let's have compassion for the fact that you're a human being with a limbic system who developed these feelings and biases. Mm-hmm. And that's really important, because as a supervisor and consultant, what I frequently hear is, oh, it's not terrible that I feel this? It's like, no, it's not terrible that you feel this. Mm-hmm. What would be more terrible is if you tried to pretend that you didn't feel this and therefore undermined your capacity to be genuinely and open-heartedly present in your work.
Mm-hmm. Kind of related to that, where we had another question about, you know, when we acknowledge, are we acknowledging openly to our clients, just to ourselves, in consultation with other colleagues or supervisors?
I would say probably not to our clients. Mm-hmm. I think that saying to our clients, you know, I'm often disgusted by you, probably not so helpful.
Right.
I think absolutely in consultation or supervision, depending upon, you know, which stage of your career you're in, mm-hmm. In our own personal therapy work. And then to ask ourselves, how is this thing showing up for me, telling me something about what's happening in the therapy? Because if my bias is being strongly evoked, is this because I haven't worked through it? Is it because I'm getting some projective identification material? If my disgust is being evoked, is it me being disgusted, or is it and or also the client self-disgust that I'm experiencing and holding? If I explore these aspects of countertransference around identities and other issues, then I'm going to be more attuned to what's happening in the non-manifest layers of the therapeutic relationship. Not saying to the client, you know, I realize I have a very hard time with Klingons, but rather saying, you know, you're probably picking up some weird stuff from me, And if you're picking up some weird stuff from me, it is my stuff. And so rather than saying it's because I'm scared to death of Klingons because you're so violent, say, you know, you might be picking up some weird energy from me. There is something weird going on. I'm addressing it in my own consultation. That might be that would be the furthest with self-disclosure I would go.
Okay.
But I would definitely address it directly in consultation and supervision.
Okay. Here's the next question, Laura. Could you talk more about the bystander effect and trauma and culture or resources that you might suggest to learn more about that perspective?
So, it's interesting because the anniversary of Kitty Genovese's death was a couple of weeks ago, and her prolonged murder in which her cries for help went unanswered by everyone around her was the beginning of research on bystander effect. We now know, incidentally, that Kitty Genovese was a lesbian, and it's possible that she was not only murdered, this was also a hate crime. Mm. But what happens when we stand by and watch oppression, violence, trauma happen is that we create a social context of betrayal. And betrayal, as we know from the work of Jennifer Fried and her associates, is itself traumatic. We participate in cultural and institutional betrayal. And so if we stand by and say, this had nothing to do with me, I didn't make this happen, and therefore there's also nothing I can do about it, then in fact what we're doing is we're adding a layer of trauma. And I think that for many people of goodwill in our professions who are primarily agent group in our identities, it's very difficult to own our participation. It's a lot simpler to say, look, you know, by the time my grandparents got here, the Native Americans had already been, you know, the targets of genocide, and there had already been slavery, and so, oh, well, there's nothing I could do about it. That's a lot easier, and it's a bystander stance, and it distances me from people who have been systematically traumatized, and whose systematic trauma has had benefits for me. If I am willing to say, okay, I benefit, and not do it guiltily, not like, oh my God, isn't this terrible, but rather acknowledge it and say, all right, what can I do today as an ally in the larger culture? What can I do to own this, not disown this? Then I am more likely to be able to proceed in a culturally competent manner in my work. There is a really good book by Jeff Mio and Laurie Rhodes, which I believe is referenced in here, on being an ally, and I've got a whole shtick on ally development that would take another couple of hours. But the opposite of a bystander is an ally, because by becoming an ally, you break out of the drama triangle, the victim, persecutor, rescuer, and then add bystander in the trauma field. You break out of that reenactment cycle, and you instead say, how do we disrupt the reenactment cycle? And so for trauma treatment, it means looking at how we could be participating in a re-traumatization and how we disrupt those narratives of trauma reenactment. But I would look at Mio and Rose's book as a really excellent place to go. And then there's a lot of work being done, both inside but largely outside the field of psychology, on being an ally, on doing anti-racism work, on doing anti-sexism work, on working against sexual violence, on being allies to people who are sexual minority or transgender. So I think that looking for opportunities to learn about becoming an ally is how we depart the bystander realm. And as somebody who was a bystander until the mid-1980s, when I had the honor of being confronted lovingly and clearly by colleagues of color who pointed out my bystander status, it can be an amazing transition. It's not easy to turn around and say, oh yeah, I've been a bystander, I've been disowning my participation. But it is so empowering to move from bystander to ally. And ally isn't easy. Ally can be hard. Ally means you get to take responsibility for yourself and for the ways you step on toes. And it feels so much more empowering. So looking for ways to learn about how to be an ally is a way to move out of bystander.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Laura, can you speak to working with clients from cultures that don't see therapy as an effective means of healing? So how do you...
I think the short answer to that is to say, okay, what is an effective means of healing for you, and how do we do that? Mm-hmm. I think a liberatory approach to psychotherapy, which is the thing I've been starting to write about recently, is not to privilege the evidence-based treatments of Western culture, but to also include the evidence base of other cultures. I mean, it's ironic that mindfulness has become the new hot thing in the mental health disciplines. Mindfulness meditation in the Buddhist tradition is a culturally competent strategy for promoting a healthy relationship with oneself and one's mind, which has a 5,000-year evidence base. It's a different kind of evidence base. It's not randomized controlled trials. It is the evidence base of thousands of years of practice. Mm-hmm. And so being open to the evidence base of the culture of the people with whom we work and expanding our notion of what kinds of evidence we take seriously is a piece of culturally competent and liberatory practice.
Okay, Laura, I think
asking, it's like, okay, what would your grandmother do? What would you do if you were at home? If this were happening, you were at home, what would you do? And empowering the person to do that and not trying to do it yourself, because you're not a curandera unless you're trained as one. You're not a shaman unless you're trained as one. You're not a hugan unless you were trained as one, and so on and so on. And the fact that you've taken the mindfulness course doesn't necessarily mean that you know how to teach it. In fact, John Briere, who is both, as we know, a brilliant trauma therapist and also a practicing Buddhist, says don't be your client's mindfulness teacher. You know, send them to someone who actually is steeped in it, for whom it is their practice, and have them learn mindfulness from someone who didn't get it as an add-on.
Okay, thank you. We have one more question, Laura, that we'll end with. How do you work with trauma survivors whose perpetrator was from a marginalized background and now the survivor has bias towards that group?
Well, we start by saying, of course you do. And I've encountered this more than a few times. We say, of course you do, because your limbic system is teaching you to overgeneralize and protect yourself and keep safe. And right now what feels like a way to be safe is to have that entire group as dangerous to you. And how does that actually not keep you safe? So you start with validating that if the person who perpetrated on you also was a member of a marginalized group, then it's an easy marker. It's the thing that the amygdala sees first. It's the, you know, rustling in bushes equals megafauna, not wind, ways that our brains do things. So we acknowledge the person's humanity. We don't shame them for it, because they're often feeling ashamed and guilty and bad about it. And I've heard this come out of a lot of people's mouths. And eventually get to the point of, how is this actually not really keeping you safe? Because as the person continues to feel badly about it or uncomfortable with people, what I talk about in trauma treatment is, how do we assess in the present, with the data of the present, whether we are safe enough or not safe enough? And having a blanket assessment of a group of people as not safe means we are inaccurately assessing both their unsafety and the unsafety of people who we haven't lumped as unsafe. So validate it, de-shame it, and then move towards teasing out the narrative of assessing safety and unsafety in more sophisticated ways when the person is not highly activated. So as you move through the trauma treatment, and I think that's one of the later stages of trauma treatment, is empowering people to be more accurate in their assessments, because avoidance is a blanket assessment of all of this is dangerous. I can't be around these people and therefore they're all bad. And I don't like that because that's not who I used to be. Or non-avoidance, which is assessing on a more case-by-case basis, which we only have the privilege to do when we are feeling safer in the world.
Laura, thank you so much. This was a really, really wonderful, informative presentation. You've given us so much good information, and I'm really excited that our Division 56 members, as well as others outside the division, had an opportunity to hear you speak today.
Well, thank you all for showing up. My apologies for going so quickly through a lot of material, and I made a decision, a conscious decision, to include more material on the PowerPoint that I could cover, so you could all take that away and think about it without me. And thank you all for your interest in and commitment to working with trauma survivors and cultural competence.
Thanks again, Laura. Before we end, I do want to let everyone know that 1 week from today will be our May webinar. It's at the same time, 12 p.m. Eastern time. It will be with Patricia Rezik, who will be giving us the most updated research and newest findings on cognitive processing therapy. Thank you so much, and we hope to see you there. Thanks again, Laura.
Thanks. Bye.
Bye-bye.